the audience was complaining too much after he composed more avant-garde stuff instead of his traditional music. So it's that little glimpse of probably like 4 years that he was able to basically capture those emotions. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Frank Bridge as a composer. And he studied in the Royal Conservatory of Music in England. He was born in Brighton in 1879. Around maybe 5 or 6 years old, he studied violin from his dad. His dad was actually a person that fixed shoes, but he really liked to play violin, and he taught him how to basically conduct at the same time. So at a young age, he got into the pre-college, and then he studied with a really famous composer, Stanford. And a lot of the students from this composer are John Ireland and Vaughan Williams as well. So these are more famous composers. So anyway, so he started at the age of 17 with violin, but they were so amazed of his compositions from the first year. He was just composing for fun, and he started playing violin. I know it says violist right there, but he played viola throughout his life. So he was just playing viola in the English quartet and the Grimston quartet as well. Those same years, he was experimenting a lot with chamber music. A lot of his works are chamber music, and they are also vocal music. He was the youngest of 11, and he was closest to the two youngest siblings. One of them, the sister, Nellie, she was a singer, and William was a cellist. So most of his compositions are for vocal, chamber music, and for cello as well. There's a violin sonata, there's other things, but I think that had a lot of influence on him with that closeness to his siblings. So then we have these, I don't know if you can see, I know it's a little far, but we have two ladies over here. The one in the middle is his wife, Ethel. She was a violinist as well. And they collaborated sometimes, but throughout the years after he graduated from RCM, he liked to do a lot of competitions. That's how he got his name out there, and that's how he got the audience to like that traditional music. We're gonna hear a little bit of that traditional style that all the audience liked, more of the Edwardian sounding, like Edward Elgar stuff, right? And then the lady on the right, or your this right for me, Frank Bridge met a sponsor from the United States, and she was very much in love with his music. And during the years after he graduated, the First World War I was coming up, and a lot of his compositions went down. He did not have any commissions. He started to teach more. So this person came along and helped him with any financial help that he needed, basically. And he had a salary for life, because she said, "I will support you until basically the day you die." So that's another reason why he didn't actually care about what people think about his music after the transition period. So, let's talk a little bit about conservatism and atonal music here. So, this is the timeline of his life. We have here in 1886 to 1906, that's the time he went to school, RCM, he studied a little bit, played with the orchestra. Then we have the year that he participated in competitions like the COBET competition, and he did a competition in Italy as well. So he mastered that conservatism in traditional music for the first 12 years. So let's say that's the first 12 years of the 1900s to the 1912. And then we have the transition period. This is the most important one, because we're catching both kind of styles. We're catching the traditional, and he's starting to experiment a little bit because of the war. And during the war years, he was a person that had a lot of, he was a very pacifist person. So being involved in the war in some ways made him a person that friends. Some people, the string quartet, the English quartet, they had to go to war. He had some friends that actually died in battle. And it was very much affected to him. He composed an organ piece for a friend of his that he lost his right hand in the battle, so he only wrote it for a left hand. And towards the end of that period, this is a rough period, which is around 1918 to 1924, he wrote the piano sonata for one of his friends. And this piano sonata is very much atonal, more on that side of, you know, Schoenberg experimentation. And a lot of people did not like that, but he didn't care because it was for somebody that he cared a lot. So throughout his music, you're gonna hear a lot of nostalgia, a lot of dreamy kind of harmonies that you can experience, especially in the cello sonata. The cello sonata and the second movement, we're gonna hear a little bit of that between the chaos and the dreamy part of things, or I guess the nostalgia of losing friends in the battle. Then, in 1918 to 1930, that's when he completely changed to modern contemporary music. And he did other compositions, but because he didn't have a lot of his music published, he wasn't as recognizable. However, towards the end of his years, one of the most noticeable composer, like Benjamin Britten, studied with him, and he tried to always basically defend him when he came into conversations or interviews or anything like that. Bridge died in 1941 from a heart attack. He was always working, he was always trying to compose and bring something new for his audience, but towards those ending years, I feel like he was decreasing in terms of recognition. However, because of the first years and the transition years, he became so noticeable in the chamber music repertoire and the cello repertoire because of the complexity and how all the harmonies work so beautifully and in a very complex way that a lot of musicians, in this case cellists and pianists, try not to so much play this music because it's a little bit hard for everybody, but it's so beautiful. So we have a little bit of examples here. We have the Fantasy in F major. We're gonna listen to it for a little bit so you can hear some of these differences.
Thank you. The next section or excerpt we're going to listen to, this is from the transitional period. And this suite is for string orchestra. The melodies are more in unison. It kind of sounds a little bit more, oh sorry, the other one sounded more Brahmsian. This one doesn't sound as Brahmsian as the traditional music. Let's see here. Tension between the chords, and this is when he started to experiment out of it a little bit of out of the traditional. I'm gonna play for maybe 30 more seconds. Shared, so and when I play the cello sonata, you hear everything that it's being mentioned. So the last section here is the avant-garde, and I'm going to play the violin sonata. And I was talking to Dr. Fadai about it, and he thought that when he found out about this, he thought it was going to sound as, I guess, cool and fun as the cello sonata, but this is more atonal than we think of. This is his later works, which is in 1932. Traditional three to four movements now. He only has two movements in the sonata. So the second movement has a couple of different sections that emulate having other movements. So this is part of the andante con moto, and then it goes to a faster section. Anyway, so then the piano part, it's a little bit more of an accompaniment, and it's a dreamy feel. Instead of like, as soon as this section is it's over, that's when the whole chaos starts, and then it repeats. So it's kind of like a memoir, basically. Some of the writers talk about how he was trying to make us feel as a memory when playing this sonata. So it's in remembrance or for his friends on the war. This other section, it's just another excerpt from the second movement, and it's just for me to show you the complexity of having like duples against triples, and then it has a different harmonic movement than the first